Oh, you're gonna leave too, huh?
Got another pet that can't hold still for the camera. Hi, Pumpkin. You haven't been around much lately. I've been outside. Y'all haven't seen Pumpkin in a while, have you? Hi, Turbo. I know. It's time to go outside. It has been so gloomy and rainy the last few days. He just hasn't had his fun time outside. Okay, so here's the... All right, first, hey, what's up, garden friends? Jeff here. How's everybody doing? Hope you're doing well. I'm great. I know. You're ready to go out. Here you go. You can go. Have at it. But no pool. You stay at the pool? I hope so. It's way too cold for the pool. It's like 52 degrees. So I was going to start the video with, it's time to move the plants out. But I think I just blew that cover, didn't I? All right. I couldn't wait. Ooh, almost forgot my caffeine. Hi. I know. Did you miss me? I missed you too. Walked away for a whopping, what was that? 3 seconds? You're so sweet. No. Oh, no. It's cold. It's gloomy. But it is time to start moving some of the plants out. Mostly just because this is like the only day where there isn't any rain in the forecast for the next several days. I already have all of these tropicals out here, the ones that were in a plant haul from a while ago. And they've been okay, with the exception of some that suffered some damage when we had an unexpected dip into the mid-30s. It's looking like temperatures, I'm only explaining this because people always ask. It's looking like temperatures are going to be staying in the 50s at night, and then possibly, hopefully going to be in the upper 80s and even low 90s next week. Not today or tomorrow, but it's going to warm up here in a couple of days. And since it's not raining today, or at least for a few hours, figured to start moving the plants out. But because there's so many plants to move out, I got on it and I already started. Moved a whole bunch out because, you know, I mean, it's just because we do it every year. It's like, okay, you see them in there and then they're out here. Figure I get most of them outside and talk about what I'm going to do with them and what needs to be done with them and get a look at how some did during the winter time. Does that sound like a plan? I hope so, because this is my only opportunity to film a video. Y'all can't even respond right now, so I don't even know why I'm asking you. Stay out of there. Oh, if he gets in there, I'm gonna be so bummed out. Too cold for that. Is that coming through the microphone? Can y'all... What the heck is that? There are a lot of strange construction sounds around here, but I don't have any idea what that is. It sounds like fire... No pool. Turbo, no. Oh, he just completely ignored me. I will be back in a moment. I gotta get him out of there, tell him off, and me and Turbo are about to have a talk. Okay, we had a conversation. He very slowly got out of the pool. He crept out and just laid down and looked at me like, I'm so sorry. Not proper training, but he knew he had done something wrong. That's the point. That's what I was getting at. I really just want to get the plants out. Give them some time to adjust. I'll have most of them down on this end for right now because they, you know, you can't just take them from the grow lights out into the blazing sun. So a lot of them are going to be hanging out down there for a week or two, but I want to get them out because it's time to start planting. I don't think I'll be able to get to it in this video, but you know, behind me, oh my gosh, there are a lot of plants, a lot of annuals and perennials ready to get into the ground and get planted, but that's probably going to have to wait. I'm sorry. Not trying to be a tease, but I just don't see myself being able to do everything in one day with this weather. So maybe that'll be in next week's vlog, probably. Let's just start with an update on the things I already got outside. Here's the croton. There it is. I started to get it potted down. I never plant it. It just sits down in there in its pot. I dig a hole for it. Put some annuals around it that helps keep it upright and steady. I remembered, though, as I was doing this, that it needs a repot, so I went ahead and stopped. See how it's leaning? But I think that's just the ground, right? Yeah, that's just the ground. Okay, that's not a big deal. Doesn't really matter since it needs a repot. So the croton is one of the plants that I tend to be more, what's the word? Careless with? Not careless, but... With the plants, you want to harden them off. You want to slowly adjust them to the light. The croton and the areca palm are the two plants I have out here where I tend to just kind of throw them on into the light. It's really not recommended to do it that way, but I've just noticed with those two plants in particular, hardening them off takes a very long time, like a solid, 6 weeks, it seems, to get them acclimated to a point where they can sit out in the sun. And then the croton still ends up throwing a fit regardless because it's
been moved and it drops leaves. So the last few years I've just said, well, screw it. I'll just go ahead and stick it in the sun. It's nice and cloudy, so it's having a few days to adjust here. Is it seashell time? We're not doing seashell time right now, Turbo. Nope, not right now. Sorry, baby. I've actually been trying to get him to not chew on the seashells because he's gotten big enough that he destroys them. So it's not as cute anymore when there's just like giant shards of sharp seashell all over the place. Anyways, yeah, it drops the leaves regardless, no matter how slowly I seem to harden it off. That's why it's already over here and not down there in the shade, because it's going to throw a fit regardless. So in a few weeks, it's probably going to drop some foliage, and then there will be lots of new growth that comes out from all these different tips that will look really tiny and look kind of funny. And then a few weeks later, it will expand out and get bigger and it will look good as new. The areca palm, it just sort of gets some bleaching on it, and then I cut those off and it pushes out new growth. That one, the only time I've like really hardened it off successfully when moving it outdoors, it took probably like, I want to say it was maybe about 2 months almost. It's a really long time. I don't want to have to wait that long. But to be safe with the areca palm, I'll probably keep it over here for a few days. I don't know. We'll kind of see how I'm feeling when I get on the dolly, because it makes more sense just to go ahead and get it put away. I have hibiscus here. This one is a really pretty variety that's like a semi-double flower. It has a pinkish-orange color on it. It's absolutely beautiful. Dracaena reflexa did really well this winter. Don't really have any reports to give on other than it seemed happy. It's not covered in mealybugs, which I was kind of expecting it to be. I have an area in the driveway where if the plants have mealybug, you can kind of see the plumeria tree over there. It's got mealybugs all over it. If they're covered in the bugs, then they're over there, so they can be sprayed more easily. Everything does get hit with an insecticidal soap and a neem when I bring it out. I went ahead and did the rest in the garage yesterday since it was raining. Got some new growth coming out there though. Looking pretty good. This plant has really done a lot of growing over the last couple years. Gotten nice and big. This is the Colorama, Dracaena marginata. The color of the Colorama part of it's not all that impressive because, you know, it was in the growth space, not getting intense light. So that will look very different here in a few weeks when that gets some more sun on it as well. The Bismarckia palm got a new frond coming out. Got one right there, and I think it has a spear down in there. Yes, it does. This one got left out to 13 degrees Fahrenheit, and that was the day I learned that that's too cold for the Bismarckia. Lost all of its foliage, but it did okay. You know, I put them through the ringer so I can report back on how they do, and it's all right. I mean, lost all of its foliage, but it didn't die. This is the variegated hibiscus, which actually I am happy to report back. This is the first time I've tried overwintering one. This thing flew through the winter, no problems at all in the house, not in the house, in the grow space. It didn't skip a beat. I don't really remember it even dropping very many leaves. Now, it's got some very spindly growth on it. Not a big deal. That's nothing a good prune won't fix. And I think it really could use a repot too. I mean, it's just in this little, I think, 12-inch Talavera pot. It's a beautiful pot. I love that pot. But it could definitely use some more space for those roots, because these will grow very quickly. They can get pretty big pretty fast. So this is easily, I would say, 4 to 5 times the size it was when I got it this time last year. And it just did wonderfully. Doesn't that look great? Didn't have any issues with bugs on it or anything like that. I didn't even have it in a spot in the grow space where it was getting really bright intense light. It just kind of got some light, sort of. It wasn't centered underneath the light, that's what I was trying to say. So it got light, but it wasn't like directly on it, which is what I expected it to need, but it did okay. And you know, the growth space, the first few months this winter, fall winter, it was fairly cool because I didn't have the heater. So it wasn't until about halfway through I got the new heater installed and really warmed things up. And it's still, during that colder part, basically did this. It put on some growth, not much. Maybe I would say like 6 inches of new stem on it. It's nothing impressive though, because it's, I mean, look at it, it's all floppy. That's the other thing. Some of the plants weren't getting quite enough airflow, which is hard to imagine because I have fans everywhere in there, but sometimes you don't really realize that they weren't getting enough airflow until you move them out and they flop over. So that's another point of the hardening off. This is a more sheltered area from the wind, and they still look like this. I moved them out and it's just been storming on top of them. So, you know, I guess that's kind of what you would expect, right? It's all windy and stormy on top of the plants. They didn't ask for that.
And I like this one. This Dracaena was standing straight up when I brought it outside.
But then the wind came and hit it. Now it's all flopped over. I could stake it, but really, I think I could go ahead and just give this a cut and let it start branching out, thicken up the stem, the trunk down there, and start to get a more full plant. Mother and daughter croton, which I think is also sometimes called the spoon croton. This one got repotted, I think, last September. Really didn't skip a beat. It's not very full right now, but that's all right. It's going to flush back out here pretty soon. As soon as temperatures get warm, I'm sure that will take off and start looking much better. I have some hedychiums down here that are waking up. This one is Slim's Orange. Hedychium is butterfly ginger, if you were wondering, if you wanted to look up a common name. And then this one is Tahitian Flame. Yeah, I think that's, yeah, Tahitian Flame. And over here I have the False Aurelia, the Dracaena Draco, which I need to pull this, get this out of the way, have a better look at it. Seemed happy. Got a lot of new growth out of it. I already pulled the old leaf bases off of there to help make it look nice, make it look tidy. Parlor palm, not much to report there. It's got some stuff I need to clean out of it, but these things, I feel like every 3 months I have to go in and do a clean out on those. They don't hold that many fronds per trunk on them, so every so often they need a clean up. That's not a big deal. Very easy to do. See how those trunks are doing. Look at those cute little trunks. Isn't it just adorable? Those tiny little palm trunks. I think so. I think it's a lovely plant. And then the Ficus altissima. This, I think it's time to go ahead and probably give this a cut, like I was talking about with the Dracaena, because it's just long and lanky. And at some point, it's going to have to start branching out. It, right now, it's just a stick. It's about a 4.5 foot long stick. So if I were to go ahead and repot that, give it a chop, then it will start to branch out and look more nice and tidy. Yeah, I talked about that last fall. This one has been on my repot list for the springtime, so that will be repotted before I move it out into more light, give it a chance to adjust to everything. You better stop. What was that? What was that? You're just doing all the bad things today. It's Turbo. We don't eat plants. He has been so good about not to, you better leave it. He's been so good about leaving the plants alone. I'm not gonna start that. Go figure. I was just telling somebody the other day about how amazed I am that he isn't digging up any of the plants. He isn't chewing on them. And then 24 hours later, pulling out a flower. It's dangling in his face. I get it, but he knows better. You saw his face. He knew he wasn't supposed to do that. He knows better. I have the gorilla cart loaded up and you can see it. Got all the stromanthes in here. Most of these were divided and repotted and, they were just divided and repotted this past winter and they all did really well. They're pretty full. I do need to come in and clean out some old foliage, some dying foliage on some of them, but otherwise there's a good amount of growth in there. They seemed very happy, as did the Prince of Orange. Look at that one. Isn't that just beautiful? That might be the prettiest leaf this one's ever put out. Which I somewhat attribute to the fact that it's overcast and it must be the lighting, because I don't know why all of a sudden it would just start throwing out leaves that were more pretty than I remember. The Prince of Orange is one of my favorite of the philodendrons. It's a very, very easy one to grow. And the new leaves, I mean, come on now. What's not to love about that? This is, well, that's just a sempervivum that was in the driveway. Gotten kind of one way. I need to fill this in. This is a Leucocasia Alocasia hybrid right here that I've had for a few years, and it didn't do great in 2020. We know why, and it has finally started to rebound and put on some good growth. I actually need to double check. That might be a Leucocasia and the Alocasia, but I can't remember. It's a cross between a Thai giant and some other wild strain. I can't remember the name though, but I'll put it up here on the screen. That's a fun plant. I haven't talked about it before. It was thought that those plants couldn't hybridize, and then they did. And I haven't been super impressed with the hybrid, but I haven't done much with it either. The philodendron, here's what happened with this one. Was doing great, pulled it out into the driveway because these can usually take more cold than a lot of the other tropicals can. And then I forgot about it. I got distracted and the sun came out and it cooked. It's okay though, quick grower. It's already put up new growth in like the, 4 days ago since that happened. Needs a repot too. Talked about that when I did the update on this. When I say it's okay, don't think that I don't take this seriously. Like I don't feel great about this having happened, but of all the plants for it to happen to, this is one that I stress out the absolute least with probably. Sturdy plant. It's gonna be fine, especially since it's about to get a repot. I have the Dracaena deramensis lime Is it just lime? Lime time? I think that's probably something from Proven Winners. I can never remember. But it's a great Dracaena. It still has the burnt up foliage from last winter, but put on a lot of new growth since then. I'll go in with some scissors and cut that stuff out. I just dropped it in this pot because I knew that it would stand up and not blow over, and I kind of like it. It's a little random, but I think that looks nice there. So it may end up staying there, but I'll try and make it look nicer, get some annuals or something planted around there. The problem is, though, I do have another one of these blue pots, and I wanted them to go on each side of this walkway here, and I think it'd be kind of odd to not have something that matches on each side. So maybe I'll just put the other blue pot somewhere else. I don't know. That's not the point of this. I gotta get the rest of the plants out. Let's just go into the garage and see what's left to move out. I don't know. First, gotta clear out the gorilla cart. Going to need this. I don't really know what to do with this right now, but figure it out. That really is going to be the biggest challenge here, is just where to put everything. So, you know, I spent so much time during the month of April getting things cleaned up and looking tidy out here, and I'm about to just unload a complete and total plant bomb onto the place. But just keep reminding myself, it's okay. It's only for like, what, maybe 2 to 3 weeks, something like that. Things will be getting planted and getting moved around, and the sun's going to shift also towards the end of May, and the light won't be quite as intense, and it's easier to move the plants around. It's easier to move the plants around, and I don't have to harden off quite the same when there are a few more shady spots out here. Love this one. So just where the plants get set, that's not necessarily where they're staying, it's just where they need to go for right now. Like this, I think, would just be perfect, nestled right there underneath the shade of the bleached out thematophyllum. Yeah, that works. The reds, they go well together. Yeah, no, I'm not putting that much thought into where these go. Just the main thing is getting them situated properly for light. I'm going to go ahead, get this cart unloaded, and then can hop into the garage and see what's left. Love these stromanthes. Oh, here it is. That's what's left. The areca palm, the monstera, and then lots of little plants. Lots of little plants. That's going to be the trick. It's figuring out where to put them all. I have an area that I think, pardon the fan, the heater, new development, won't turn off. So that's fun. I have to go downstairs and flip the breaker to turn it off. I have to contact the manufacturer about that new problem. I cleared out an area over where I put the potting bench where the pond used to be, and I think that that would be a fine spot to maybe have a nice long plant stand for all the little things. So that is my plan there. I just came up with it like 10 minutes ago, so it's not going to happen right now, but that's where a lot of these will go. I don't think I should take the heliconias out yet. I mean, why would I do that to them when it's going to be in the 80s and 90s in a couple of days? Why subject them to the cold? Really though, is that the case with everything? Should I wait? It's only 2 more days. Maybe I should just wait. Try and get the areca palm out. I know this one doesn't care about the temperatures being a little bit lower. Turbo can see me. I don't know what to do there. That really throws off my plans. That's what I was going to do for the vlog, but it just doesn't make sense. If it's going to be in the 60s with these cold nights the next couple of days, why put them through that kind of shock? It's been a solid 78 to 84 in here for a few months. Why not just wait 2 more days, right? Well, I can tell you why. It's because I don't feel like it. I want to get this done. I know the monstera I don't want to take out right now because it has a new leaf opening up. You know, their new leaves tend to be really floppy and flimsy. I don't want to damage it in the process of moving the plant around. And the only reason the other plants are even out there right now is that heater just horribly obnoxious. It probably is. You're being noisy. The forecast was saying that it was going to be warmer than it has been, and that's why I had even moved these out. But I made sure to move out the plants that would be more sturdy to cooler temperatures, if you know what I mean. What's left in there is mostly plants that are going to be more tender, plants that I don't want to experience the cold. The problem is, though, it's not going to warm up until the day after this video comes out. And my plan was to move the plants out for this video. So I'm just like, well, what do we do? What do you guys want to do? I know y'all like the long videos for the Saturday videos. And that was, well, that time of year, forecast is always changing. Kind of just got to roll with it, I suppose. I suppose maybe this will be a two-parter. Maybe I'll just, Wednesday's video, we'll finish getting the rest of the plants out. I'm not ready to end things, though. This feels way too short. Oh, we'll figure something out. Be right back. I just remembered I do have some new plants here that I wanted to... Okay, really? I didn't even point the camera at the table. I do have some new plants that I wanted to talk about some fun, more like kind of unusual plants that I picked up. There will be a plant haul in next Saturday's video. Just scheduling wise, I had to plan that out in advance because I'm not going to really have much time to do a lot of filming or editing next week, because it just happens to be like when it rains, it pours socially. You know, I made plans for the weekend and stuff. Nobody cares. Next weekend, it's more annuals, tropicals, some perennials. Well, actually, I think I'm going to show you all the perennials right now. Annuals and tropicals next weekend. Right now, I have, well, some annuals and tropicals. Putting way too much thought into this. Let's just look at the plants. Beautiful, right? Look at that leaf. This is a Begonia grandis variety Evansiana. The tag is right there. Hopefully we can see it. I don't know. I can't see my viewfinder. There we go. I love a cold hardy Begonia. Begonia grandis in general, there are lots of fun varieties to choose from. The Evansiana is one that I have read from somewhere. I can't really remember where. I recall somebody speculating that it's perhaps not even a grandis, that it might be its own group. If you search for it, you may just find Begonia Evansiana or Begonia grandis variety Evansiana. Those leaves, aren't they fun? Look how big and kind of wonkily shaped they are. I know, that's not a word. The Evansiana gets, I think the tag said 18 inches tall. I thought they got a little bit bigger than that. And they have like a typical begonia flower that will come off the tip with pretty pink flowers. Again, here's the tag. If you want a better look, I was kind of quick with that before. So you can kind of see those fun flowers that come off the edge there. Hardy to zone 6 with some protection. They should be fully hardy to zone 6. I've never had any issues with this one coming back when I planted it for other people before. I did pick up 3 of these because, you know, one's never enough with the perennials. Yeah, see that? I mean, look how big that leaf is. Gigantic. So these are a great plant for if you're doing like a woodland setup. Beautiful plant. They also, I mean, for what I do out here where I want a more the tropical kind of vibe, excellent plant for that too because of the great big foliage. They have that red veining on the inside. Isn't it beautiful? I love that red veining. I would actually enjoy doing a video just on the hardy begonias, but I don't know if, like, that's just a me thing, so I've never done it before. I don't know if that's something other people would watch. Comment down below if that's something you'd be interested in, because there's a fair amount to talk about with them. There are a lot of neat types to try out. There's one I really want called Smooch, but okay. No, I need to shut up because then if I end up doing that video, I will have given everything away in this one. Fun plants, great perennials. They'll get nice and big. I have an area kind of down towards that berm. Like I'm doing like the flight attendant point over to that direction. You can even see the berm. It's a spot where these should come up and over some smaller plants that will be planted in the front. Just fun, great plants. Not my favorite of the hardy begonias, but I don't see them available at the nurseries all that often. So I wanted to snatch them up. The heron's pirouette. It's a beautiful, common hardy begonia. That's a good one to look out for. Gets much larger. The foliage is a little bit smaller than on this. I mean, I don't usually see them with foliage anywhere near that big. It has a little bit more of a gloss to it, and I think it flowers more profusely than the Evansiana. It's a different look. But that's a good one to look out for as far as the more common types go. You might see it at a nursery. Left the price tags on. I'm sorry, that was tech. I just cut my fingernails. Those aren't coming off. Okay, so this one we need to talk about. Firelight Tidbit Panicle Hydrangea. Very happy about this one. It's one I've wanted for a very long time. I'm gonna try and hold that still, so hopefully you can read it. Pause the video if you want to like really get in there and get to that description. Sun part shade. The main attraction with this one is that it only gets 2 to 3 feet tall. That is fantastic. There's so much more you can do with a panicle hydrangea that doesn't have to be in the background. These would be excellent being, well, you get it, planted around something. But the thing we need to talk about with this is that in the garden tour that came out last Saturday, so the like last weekend's vlog, I showed the little lime punch. And I said in that video that I had been trying really hard to find one and I was only able to find one, but I was really happy about it. It's the wrong plant. I'm glad I got the little lime punch, but I got my crazy proven winners names mixed up in my head. The Firelight Tidbit is the one that I had been trying to get a hold of And then I saw the little lime punch at a nursery and I was like, that's the one. I had it written down in my phone though. And it said little lime punch. I had been on the computer going through their website during the wintertime trying to plan out some perennials for the year. And I wrote down little lime punch. But I remember my reason for that being that it stays smaller. But the little lime punch I think is 3 to 5 feet or 3 to 6 feet. I can't really remember. So I don't know why I wrote that one down and not the firelight tidbit, because the firelight tidbit stays smaller. I know, pure cognitive chaos there. Sorry, I had to drag y'all in it. But I wanted to explain why I am going to have both of them in the garden now, because I got it wrong. This is a smaller plant. They'd had them in a bigger size, but it was another $20. And I was like, this one doesn't even really get that big. You know, you're paying for time when you go for a larger plant, but this one isn't going to get that big, period. So I just didn't see a reason to spend that extra money for the bigger one. So I got two of these in this size. I should have gotten three. It was one of those moments where I was at the nursery and I was seeing them and I was like, wait a minute, that's what I was supposed to be getting, was a firelight tidbit, not the little lime punch. And then I was like, but now I just have one little lime punch and what am I going to do? So I got another little lime punch. And two, it didn't make sense. I need to go back and get a third because they need to go around an area where I'll be putting it. That's what happened there. It's a really cute little panicle hydrangea. Has these beautiful flowers on it, very similar to the vanilla strawberry. I would imagine nowhere near as full, and it should be more upright. The vanilla strawberry are the hydrangeas that I had planted down around the wall, and then I moved them over into those pots not that long ago, just a few weeks ago. Those have really gigantic flower heads on them that weigh the plant down. These are improved. And it's not even the same hydrangea, but the flower is very similar. They'll come out white and then they'll age into getting that pink on them. So fun, exciting new plant, and me telling you too much about what happened when ADD kicked in while I was at a nursery and trying to plant out my garden this year. It doesn't help that the names with the proven winners plants can be really hard to follow. That was my justification in my brain, was why I had that screw up. I mean, firelight tidbit, well, it's a tidbit, that means tiny, and it's, so it's a tiny version of the firelight. I mean, okay, when you think about it, it makes more sense. I was wondering if maybe I wanted the little lime punch because they have more red in the flat. Would it help if I showed you I'll get the plant. There we go. Little lime punch. I'll back the camera up. Larger size here, and it would help if you could see that tag. I bet you'd appreciate that. There's a lot more red in there, deeper tones of pink, and I guess lighter tones to make what would be red to pink. It's a smaller version of the limelight, which is a great hydrangea. This will stay much smaller though and have reddish pink flowers. So maybe I just wanted the red. I don't know. That's not typically something I would do. Do y'all ever do that when you're doing your winter planning online, trying to pick out your plants and plan things out, and then springtime comes and you're like, wait, what? Well, if that's what happened there. It's not a big deal. They're both beautiful plants. I'm going to be happy to have them around the garden. It's just been trying to figure out what my logic was there when I thought this was the one that I was supposed to get, when I knew that I wanted the one that stayed really, really tiny. 3 to 5 feet tall is still a nice compact size, but it's not as compact as 2 to 3 feet tall. Okay, we can move on now. Sorry about that. This one's fun. Look at those leaves. Aren't they just beautiful? This is a geranium. It's a crocodile geranium. Beautiful pink flowers on it and just awesome foliage. Kind of gives me like sort of maybe stained glass vibes. 12 to 18 inches tall, 9 to 12 inches wide. What I've read about the crocodile geranium is that it is one that will potentially be more of a trailer, but 12 to 18 inches tall and only 9 to 12 inches wide would suggest otherwise. Those we'll find out together. I just really like the foliage on it. Thought it was fun. It's something unique, something that'll stand out in a planter. I think that that's really a fun color, a fun variation to have with those pink flowers. That's going to look neat. I really like that. I'm picky about my geraniums because the sun in my backyard, it's pretty intense right now, but towards the end of the growing, or really middle of the growing season, probably a few weeks into July, more into August, the sun starts to shift, the trees are fully flushed out, and I don't always have the best sun for geraniums out here, at least not in a convenient spot. The middle of my patio gets a ton of sun, but not the places where I can actually put plants. I can't just throw them in the middle of the pool. So that would be fun. Plant up a little island full of plants. So as much as I love geraniums and would like to have more of them out here, I do have to be picky because there's only so much space that gets enough sun for them. I think that's a fun addition. And I like to bring the geraniums in during the winter. I brought in the, I think it's called like coral sunrise or coral guacamole. I don't remember clearly because I doubt the name was coral guacamole. I overwintered a geranium last winter and it was so easy, really simple to do, that it just makes me want to keep buying more and more and more of them. Actually, I think the plant, I could potentially have it do better inside than outside. And that's fun. That's just more flowers to be able to have during the winter time in the grow space. I didn't do amazing this winter. Y'all have seen it in the plant tours before. But that was more because I was kind of playing around with it, learning the lights and the heat and everything. But I have a better gauge now of what it would like under that artificial lighting, and I could too. Anyways, I plan on holding on to this one. I don't really plan on treating this as an annual. That was the entire point there. But that could change. Who knows? I could end up having this out here all season and being like, eh, it's not doing anything for me. It's going to take up space on the shelves. Maybe it won't perform that well. Just because something's pretty doesn't mean it's going to be around for a long time. I'm not much for the high maintenance plant. It doesn't need to be sturdy like a typical geranium would be. Okay, next one. It's not going to be that exciting to look at yet, but someday it will be. It's a Colocasia. It just looks like a normal, everyday, average Colocasia right now. As it's small, it's going to take time for this one to start looking nice. This is the white lava, which is fairly common. I think it might be one of the more trendy ones right now. I don't particularly know why, because it's not by any means a new one. This one, when it gets the right amount of sun and it gets to be the proper size, has really beautiful white variegation on the inside of the foliage. I don't know if we'll get there this year or not. May not get to see that variegation until next year. I would think that it should come through this year, though. It really should. Colocasias, like, get them in the ground, they really take off and start performing very, very well. So hopefully there will be lots of nice color on that one in, I don't know, a couple months? We will see. And there is another type, very similar to the white lava, from the same plant breeder, John Cho, who does the Hawaiian series, the Royal Hawaiian series. Has a lot of fun, beautiful hybrids of Colocasia. And it's called, what is it called? Maui Sunrise, I think is the name. It has some more variegation, but it's supposed to start showing that variegation a lot earlier in the season. If you can find that one, that might be a better option. This is pretty cheap. So I went ahead and I grabbed it, so I wanted to give it a try. I would prefer the Maui Sunrise, or there's actually one called Waikiki that is just beautiful. But it takes a couple of years, I believe, for all of its color to start setting in on the plant. And I don't think it's available all that often, but I don't know. I'm on the list. Hopefully someday I'll be able to get it. This one. That's what's next. Another elephant. You can't see that. Alocasia silver giant. Isn't it beautiful? Look at those stems. Oh, there it is. Look at that. Beautiful, glossy, very light green, kind of a silvery tone to it on that foliage. Turbo's found a plastic coconut to play with. The beautiful texture inside of the leaves. I was really happy to see this one at a nursery this year, because it's one of those ones where I think it's kind of being classified as one of the more like designer Alocasias. And I had wanted to order some of these last fall. There was a seller who reached out to me who was wanting to send a box of plants, and it was just the wrong time of year. Those companies always reach out to me in like November. I get it, before the holidays, but the weather, it's too cold. Like, I don't want to get into a deal with somebody saying, all right, I'm going to pick out these plants, thanks for sending them to me. And I like the opportunity to be able to give everybody a code to order things discount. However, it doesn't make sense when the temperatures might be in the teens one day and then in the 70s the next day. It's just too risky. So it was the only plant that they had that I was kind of bummed about not being able to get. Everything else they had were fun plants, but the silver giant is one that I had really wanted. There's a backstory there. I was happy to see it at a local nursery for a reasonable price. I was concerned at that time when all that stuff was going on last fall that it was maybe going to be one of those Alocasias that just costs a lot of money. And maybe it is. Maybe I just got lucky. I'm not sure. I didn't dig in any further. Wow, that street construction is getting really noisy. It's almost like a silvery blue color. Now, it's kind of hard to describe. I like the texture. I like the shade of green, is what I would call that. It's a very shiny, shimmery green. But it does lend itself towards the silvery blue end of the spectrum, I suppose. Glad I was able to find it. The price was good. I just looked them up. Apparently they are kind of pricey, at least on Etsy. So that was a good find. As this matures and gets larger, and some more sun, the foliage should start to take on more of like a lighter bluish to green silvery hue. Just have to watch over the summer. You'll get to see it. These are very, very, very pretty Alocasias. And that's It's not everything. I got a lot more plants to show y'all. But I think that that's good for right now as far as plants that are more standout-ish and not just like annuals and fillers and those sorts of things. Though there are a few fun ones for the next plant haul. I hope everybody's doing well. Thanks for hanging out. Well, things are just weird and chaotic. It's that time of year. Keep saying it. I mean, I'm going to be saying that all year, right? Storms and whatnot. You just never know what you're going to get, but it's been very rainy here, so just haven't had a lot of time to be outside and do much filming. So White Turbo's been very hyper because he's been pent up inside. Been trying to play with him and get him some exercise, but it's hard when it's raining nonstop. What is he even up to? He's just blowing bubbles in the pool? What's he doing? Where'd he go? There he is. What you doing, baby? What you doing? What's going on? You're very cute. Very cute, Turbo, just playing with leaves and sticks. Oh, he dropped a seashell in there. That's why he was blowing bubbles. There's a shell down there at the bottom. I don't know what to tell you, Turbo. You're going to have to hold on and wait for me to get the net out to get that thing out. I know. I'm sorry. We'll get that out of there for you. Poor Turbo. In the next video, hopefully get the rest of the plants out here. Hope you understand. It's just, if it's going to be in the 60s with lows in the lower 50s, maybe upper 40s for two more days, just why would I go ahead and move those more delicate plants out and just wait 2 days and it'll be in the 80s and 90s. I think that the plants would appreciate that transition more, right? I think so. Hope everybody's doing well, having a great day and a great life. Everything's just going beautifully for you. Look at these pansies. They've really started to come up. You know, when you plant them more dense, you can get some height out of them. Looking great. Absolutely beautiful. Comment down below. Say hi. I love talking to everybody. What's going on in your gardens? Are things finally starting to warm up? I know I've been saying that at the end of every single video for like the last month. It's been an unusually cool spring. We had a few warm days, but not as many as we usually would. Just give it one more week and I'll be out here just complaining about how horribly hot it is. It's just a big change. You know, in 2 days, it's going to be 30 degrees warmer than it is right now. It's going to take some time to adjust, but I'm looking forward to it. The plants are going to enjoy it. I will enjoy it. Won't be outside in May. Pants on, and we'll also have pants on. You know what I mean? We'll have the hoodies and all that. It's time to go. My brain's done. All right. As always, and most importantly, everybody, say goodbye, Turbo. Shaking all that water around. Okay, not when I have the camera. Keep on growing. Bye-bye.